Good morning. Good morning. Sure, I'm on. Yes, I am. Welcome to worship here at Kemnay Parish Church. Welcome to all who are here in the sanctuary. Welcome to our church family watching at Littlewood Court. And a special welcome as well to those who are up at the church center today for our first Super Sunday. I hope they can see that. So Super Sunday starts today. So along with worship here at the church, starting at the same time at 10 o'clock, there'll be a time of relaxed fellowship and worship at the Kirk Center as they watch the live stream service together and have a chance to catch up. And when Super Sunday is on, our Children's Explorers Sunday School will be at the church center, in addition to toys being pulled out for little ones. And following the service, all here are welcome to come to the center today for a cup of coffee and a sweet treat. Unfortunately, the cooker is down at the center, so there's no soup in Super Sunday this week, but that should be rectified in due course. And as you can see listed on your intimation, there'll be future meetings for Super Sundays on the fourth Sunday of each month, the 27th of October, and that'll be a shared lunch edition, and the 24th of November for an Advent-focused Super Sunday as well. In order to make these events a success, we need to grow our team of volunteers and helpers. If you're able to help, please speak with me, or if you see her, please speak with my lovely wife, Heather, to make your interest known. And we'll share the rest of our intimations later in the service. So with that shared, we give thanks for the gift of this day together. We give thanks for the gift of being able to worship the Lord together. So in a spirit of thanksgiving and praise, let us sing our first song. And during the singing of this song of praise, our offering for God's continued work here in Kemnay and beyond will be uplifted. Let us pray. Creator God, we glimpse your beauty in the setting sun, in the mountaintop on eagle's wing. We sense your power in the thunder crash and the ocean's roar. and we praise you for all that you have created. Lord Jesus, in our lives, we see your love overcoming every hurt. We stand in awe of who you are. You, love incarnate, poured out for all of humankind. Holy Spirit, we see your power in lives transformed, in hearts set ablaze. And in the next few moments of silence, Holy Spirit, we listen for your still, small voice. From the moment we awake to face the day ahead, Lord, you are with us. Through good times and in difficult times, your presence is enough for our needs. So every day we praise you and extol your name forever. Through the hours of the day, in our travels and in our work, you are with us. In the decisions we must make, your wisdom is enough for our needs. Every day we praise you and extol your name forever. And as we lay down to rest at the end of each day, you are with us then too. As we lay our fears and concerns at your feet, your peace, your shalom is enough for our needs. So every day we praise you and extol your name forever. Lord God, your love for us extends throughout history. It touches every life. Your love sees every failing and forgives. Your love feels every pain and wipes away our tears. Your love knows grief and yet comforts the sorrowful. Your love sees sin and still loves the sinner. Forgive us, Lord, when we fail to live lives that reflect your love. Forgive us the many times when we take for granted all that you have done and are doing for us. Use this time of worship together to bind us together as a family. Transform us, Lord, through your Spirit. Make us more and more like Jesus. Empower us to serve you this day and every day. And as a sign of our faith, our confidence in you, Lord, we now join our voices together in the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We now sing our next song of praise, To Be in Your Presence. As we announced at the start of our service, today is the first Super Sunday at the Church Center. So all of our children who are associated with our Explore Sunday School over there at the center, with Heather and with David Hendricks and with a team of parents and volunteers, and we are mindful of them as we continue in worship here, that even though we're in separate buildings, we are worshiping together. And that's made possible through the wonders of technology as well. And so join me now in a brief word of prayer and blessing, please, over our children and all those at the Church Center. Let's pray. Loving God, we give you thanks for the resources we have as a church, for the gift of this building of worship, for the gift of the Church Center. We thank you for every child who is at the center today, for every member of our Explore Sunday School, for every parent and guardian and auntie and uncle and grandparent and friends who make this time of teaching, this time of formation possible. We pray your blessing, Lord, upon this first Super Sunday. May it be a time of rich fellowship for all who partake, and may you use this time of worship here in the church and at the center. May you use this time, Lord, to help us to hear you and to know you more and more. We pray these things in Jesus' name, and we pray them for his sake. Amen. Part of the joy of the Explorers Sunday School is a chance to learn more together about the good news of Jesus Christ. And it's a reminder for all of us, no matter what stage of life you're at, we all have need and room to grow in our faith with God. And so in that spirit, we now sing our next song, We Need to Grow.
We need to grow, grow.
This morning's reading comes to us from the Old Testament, from the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 3, and this can be found on page 274. The boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. And in those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. Then one night, Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak that he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. And then the Lord called Samuel. And Samuel answered, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." But Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." And so he went and lay down. And again the Lord called Samuel. And Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." "My son," Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, for the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. Then the Lord called Samuel a third time, and Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." Then Eli realized that the Lord was calling the boy. So Eli told Samuel, "Go and lie down, and if he calls you, say, 'Speak, Lord, your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. And the Lord came and stood there calling, as at the other times, "Samuel, Samuel." Then Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." And the Lord said to Samuel, "I'm about to do something in Israel that will make the ears of everyone who hears it tingle. At that time, I will carry out against Eli everything I spoke against his family from beginning to end. I told him I would judge his family forever because of the sin he knew about. His sons made themselves contemptible. He failed to restrain them. Therefore, I swore to the house of Eli, the guilt of his house will never be atoned for by a sacrifice or offering." Samuel lay down until morning and then opened the doors of the house of the Lord. He was afraid to tell Eli the vision, but Eli called him and said, "Samuel, my son." And Samuel answered him, "Here I am." And he asked, "What was it he said to you? Do not hide it from me. May God deal with you, be it ever so severely, if you hide from me anything he told you." So Samuel told him everything, hiding nothing from him. Then Eli said, "He is the Lord. Let him do what is good in his eyes." The Lord was with Samuel as he grew up, and he let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, recognized that Samuel was attested as a prophet of the Lord. The Lord continued to appear at Shiloh, and there he revealed himself to Samuel through his word. Amen. And thanks be to God for this reading from his holy word. And to the Lord be praise and glory and honor forever and ever. We now sing our next song of praise, "Draw Me Close to You."
Never let me go.
Let us pray. Lord, you really are all that we need. You are the answer to every hope. You are the calming of every fear. You are the peace for which our hearts, our minds, and our souls yearn. As we pause together, as we reflect together on your word to us, we pray that your Holy Spirit would help us understand. We pray that your Spirit would draw us closer to you and to each other. And may the words of my mouth and may the meditations of our hearts and our minds be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. Lord, you are the strength of all who place their trust in you. Amen. The other day, Heather and I made a trip into the city to Aberdeen for one of Heather's favorite activities, shopping. I said one of Heather's favorite activities. As we were walking around, and she's actually a wonderful shopper, she's very efficient, she knows what she wants, so I should be thankful. But as we were walking around, one thing that struck me was the sheer number of different stores and shops that dealt with mobile technology, with phones. It seems like every time I go into the center of Aberdeen, there's another pop-up shop with another carrier, another brand for phone providers from which people have to choose. And every single one as you walk by has these big, colorful, loud, splashy advertisements, don't they? Get such and such for only such and such per month. And then the tiny print that no one bothers to read at the bottom that says what it's really all about. But naturally, every one of these carriers, doesn't matter which one you have, they all claim to be the best, don't they? You ever seen one of these phone carriers advertised saying, we're the second best? Because it would imply, well, who's the first, right? Everyone claims to be the best deal on phones, the best coverage, the best data, the best contracts, the best everything, right? And this kind of marketing, I think, plays to our desires. And I think we know how upset we can all get when these promises of the best coverage, the best data, the best minutes, blah, 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 are less than fulfilled when the reception, the data, and the coverage are not as robust as advertised. And as we know, this is because we as people desire to be heard and understood by others, to have better connections with other people. Right? Zooming out, life, I think, can be very challenging when, whether it's through our technology or through our relationships or anywhere, life can be very hard and challenging when our connection to other people is something less than robust, something less than complete. We're social creatures. We need relationship. We need each other. We need to be connected to things outside of ourselves to feel complete. And if it's that hard not to feel connected to other people, how much harder is it, I wonder, for us as people of faith to sometimes feel disconnected from God? And as we know, we're going through 1 Samuel. And 1 Samuel, as we've heard, deals with a time in Israel's history when they're transitioning from a tribal federation to a monarchy. We also know from the beginning of 1 Samuel about the sorry state of Israel's religious life at this time. We've heard in previous chapters about the wickedness of Eli's sons. Eli was the leading priest of his time. And this combination of political and social confusion and religious decline resulted in Israel feeling disconnected from God. So let's look at this text together and see what it has to teach us this morning. Looking at our first few verses, verses 1 through 3. The story actually begins not with God speaking, but it begins with God's silence. Look at what it says in verse 1. It says, "The boy Samuel ministered before the Lord under Eli. In those days, the word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions." The word of the Lord was rare. There were not many visions. This was a time in Israel's history when Israel was not well connected to God. Sure, there was the occasional prophet, such as a man of God who came to Eli in chapter 2, but by and large, there was no prophetic word from God to his people, Israel. But all that was about to change through the story of God calling Samuel. The text continues in verses 2 and 3. It says, "One night Eli, whose eyes were becoming so weak he could barely see, was lying down in his usual place. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was." I think the details here are very rich in symbolism. The text tells us that Eli's eyes are so weak, which is reminding us of his weak spiritual vision. He did nothing when his sons made a mockery of the priesthood. His fading eyesight, his fading vision is symbolic, I think, of the time in Israel when the word of the Lord was rare and there were not many visions. And yet, the text also says that the lamp of the Lord had not yet gone out. It was the priest's job to light the lamp every day to keep it burning. So even in the midst of spiritual blindness, even in the midst of confusion, even in the midst of a lack of connection to God, there was still hope. The lamp had not yet gone out. And in the midst of this scene, with Eli lying down in his usual place, with Samuel lying close to the ark, then in verse 4 and following, this call came to Samuel. The Lord called Samuel, and Samuel answered, "Here I am." And he assumed it was Eli. So he ran to his master and said, "You called me." But Eli said, "I did not call. Go back and lie down." I wonder if every parent can relate to this in some respect. Woken up middle of the night by a child saying, "Did you call me?" "Here I am." Like, "Go back to bed." And so Samuel went back to bed. And I love this scene. Because as soon as Samuel hears this message, he's alert. He's responsive. He's ready to go. He's obedient. He's obedient to Eli. "You called me. Here I am." And it happens again, a second time. Samuel is called, goes to Eli. "Wasn't me who called you. Go back and lie down." Now, I think part of the beauty of this passage for us is that we know from the outside who is calling Samuel, don't we? Right from the start. But Eli just doesn't get it. And it's yet another example of Eli's spiritual sluggishness. We saw it with Eli and Hannah when he assumed that she was drunk when she was praying in chapter 1. We saw it when his failure to restrain his sons. And now we see it, he's slow on the uptake when it comes to what Samuel is experiencing. This explains Eli. But what about Samuel? Why didn't Samuel know it was God calling him instead of Eli? We find out in verse 7 when it says, "As Samuel did not yet know the Lord, the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him." And we've heard before, when the Bible talks about knowing somebody like this, it talks about to be in close, intimate relationship with them. Samuel was just a boy, maybe between 10 and 12 years old. Yes, he had served in the temple, but he didn't have intimate, direct knowledge of God yet. That was about to change. After God's word was revealed to him, Samuel would learn as he grew to recognize God's voice speaking to him in his life. And so the third time, finally, the Lord called Samuel again. He got up and went to Eli. And then finally, Eli realized that it was the Lord calling the boy. So Eli told him, "Go and lie down. If he calls you again, don't come to me," he says, "but instead say, 'Speak, Lord, your servant is listening.'" And so Samuel went down to lie down in his place. And so we know the call came again. The Lord called him Samuel. Samuel. This was the key turning point in Samuel's life right here. And how did he respond? He took the very good advice that Eli gave him. He replied, "Speak, for your servant is listening." I think this is a great prayer to pray anytime before trying to hear God, before reading scripture, before praying. It shows a desire to hear, a willingness to listen, and a heart that is ready to serve and obey. Speak. Your servant is listening. I don't know about anybody else here, but I'm becoming more and more convinced that true listening is becoming a lost art. If you need convincing of this idea, just watch any political talk show. Talking at versus talking with. So what does it take? What does it really take to listen? What does it really take to listen? I'm curious. Time. Good. What else does it take? Attention. Space. Patience, right? How about energy? Yeah. Closing your mouth, opening your ears. Yes. Reminded of my parents were fond of telling me, yeah, one of these, two of these. There's a clue right there, right? Yeah. Anybody else hear that growing up? Yeah. So is real listening, can it be hard work? Yeah. Really hearing somebody. Right. I think that's one of the reasons why, because we live in an age of instant gratification, of instant technology. Click a button, you get packages to your door. It's pretty impressive. You go onto Facebook and get overwhelmed with information, but do you really hear anything more often than not? Do you really learn anything? Probably not. Very little. Versus actually taking the time to sit with somebody face-to-face, eye-to-eye, and say, "How are you? Tell me about you. Help me know you better." I think it takes a real willingness to put the other person before ourselves if we want to listen, if we want to hear. It takes a lot of time and effort and energy to really listen to somebody. We have such a temptation when trying to listen, to spend more time trying to formulate our own responses. I'm probably going to regret telling this story, but I'll say it anyways. I remember growing up, and especially my times with my father, I loved to argue and debate growing up, but still do, if I must have to be honest. And there are so many times where I wouldn't really hear what my dad said because I was so concerned with thinking about what I wanted to say back to him. You know, and so he would say something, and then I would say, "Yeah, but," and so he decided my name should have been Yabut instead of Joshua. Got better over time, thankfully. So if takes that much effort and hard work to listen to other people, and it's worthwhile to do so, we must say that too, this willingness to listen is even more true for our relationship with God. I remember when I was in seminary back in New Jersey, during my first year of study, I found myself so busy learning theology that I had very little time to actually listen to God. One of those weird ironies of life. And so a good friend of mine named Michael, he suggested after a challenging semester that we take a break and we hop on a plane to France, because why not, and go to the Taizé community in rural France. And if you don't know about Taizé, it's an ecumenical monastery in France, all sorts of Christians coming together for communal worship and life together. And at the Taizé community, Worship happens three times a day, morning, afternoon, and evening. It's led by the brothers and sisters of the community. And the nature of Teze worship is purposefully simple, centered on three S words: singing, scripture, and silence. When I first got to Teze, I loved the singing. I knew some of the music before I went, which is part of the appeal. Of course, I was fine with hearing scripture, especially they read it in multiple languages from across the globe. It was beautiful to hear it. But the silence in the service was hard for me, especially those services during the week which had more silence than singing or scripture. I have distinct memories of being in the sanctuary at Teze, of trying to sit quietly on the floor with a type of kneeler that supported the legs and the back so they didn't go numb. But as I tried to be still, as I tried to be silent, my mind would not stop flitting back and forth, jumping from one anxiety to the next. And at first, this time of silence only aggravated my anxiety. And I found myself wondering if I could sneak out the sanctuary without anybody noticing. If I could do something more productive with my time, like taking a walk around the monastery and thinking deep thoughts and having good conversations. But something told me to keep at it, to not give up. And so I did keep at it. Plus, I was too embarrassed to leave the sanctuary. And over the next couple of days, in this rhythm of worship, of singing, scripture, and a lot of silence, something started to change in me. When I went to worship, I found myself, almost without realizing it, looking forward to the silence more than I was looking forward to the music and to the readings. I found that normal life was loud and busy enough that I needed these times of silence and stillness. I still had moments of distraction and fidgeting in worship, of course, but the silence was becoming comfortable. Why? Why was it becoming comfortable? I'd like to think it was because I was painfully slowly, learning the importance of being still and listening to God, and listening for God. And in doing so, I was becoming aware of a great need that I never even knew I had. Up until that point, I always thought of prayer as a verbal exercise. But that time at Teze showed me that prayer is also an exercise in stillness, in listening, in being quiet. And it wasn't that God spoke every time I was quiet, but I did feel an almost indescribable peace when I was able to be still. And what I did learn from that time in Teze is with the importance of cultivating this kind of space in my life so that I could be quiet and try and hear God speak. And just so I'm clear, I am still very much in the process of learning the importance of listening to God. More often than not, more times than I care to admit, I go back to square one with this practice. But I'm fairly certain that maybe we're all like that, and that the art of listening to others and to God is a lifelong process. And I think this is true for Samuel in our story as well. This beautiful text, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." I think throughout his entire life, his entire ministry as one of the greatest prophets in the history of Israel, Samuel had to keep pausing in his life to say, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." We can't live the Christian life on our own. We cannot find our own way forward. If we plow on as Christians, trying to do it all under our own steam, trying to do it without listening to God, we won't get very far. Remember that Jesus said in the gospel, "I am the vine, you are the branches. Apart from me, you can do nothing." To live as disciples of Jesus, we must ask God to help us listen for his voice, to listen for the voice of Jesus, who is calling each of us into new ways of living every single day. I think Samuel's prayer is a great prayer to pray first thing in the morning. Speak, Lord, your servant is listening today. Try again in the afternoon. Speak, Lord, your servant is listening this afternoon, into the evening, before we go to bed at night. It's living into this posture of listening. Of listening to God and listening to others. I think we deprive ourselves needlessly of so much peace and healing every day of our lives when we don't take time to listen. When we don't step away from the noise of the world and practice being still and knowing that God is God. So I'll close with a question. Are we listening? Are we living in ways which help us and allow us to hear God? Or are we living in ways, are there things in our life which make it hard for us to hear Him? And if so, why are we holding on to those things? Are we listening? May God give us the same grace that He gave to Samuel and to so many others, so that when God does speak into our lives, we too will be able to say, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." Amen. We now sing together, "Speak, O Lord."
Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all.
have a few intimations to share now. We'll have focus slides. James, you wouldn't mind posting the first one, please? The next slide, please, James. There we go. Thank you. The first has to do with our church cleaning rota. Well, we are in need of two people to join the church cleaning team, even on a temporary basis. And if you are free to help with this, please make your availability and your interest known to the church center. Thank you very much. Next, please, James. A reminder that tonight, here in the church at 6:30 p.m., we have our next evening service of praise with songs, and the theme for this evening is highest praise. And a very warm welcome is extended to all to come along and join us for worship tonight. Your support for these events is always warmly appreciated, and of course, we'll have refreshments and fellowship after worship tonight as well. So please do come along, 6:30 tonight. Next, please. A reminder that this Friday, the 27th of September, we'll have a Macmillan coffee morning with loaves and fishes and mainly music together. This Friday, the 27th of September at 9:30 until 11:30 at the Church Center. So please do come along and have a cup of tea and some fellowship and, of course, support the wonderful work of Macmillan Cancer Support. Next, please. This is an intimation about a very special event called Cakes, Bakes, and Faith Tour. And this features two individuals, Martha Collison and Will Torrent. And I've been told by a very reputable source, this fellow here, that they are known to us through the Great British Bake Off TV show. Is that correct? Yes. And Martha and Will are both Christians. And so they're going on this tour to talk, well, about cakes, bakes, and the Christian faith. And there's a number of dates that and locations, but the one closest to us will be in Aberdeen on the 23rd of October at Aberdeen Christian Fellowship. So if you'd like more information about this event, you can see the information listed at the bottom for the website for tierfund.org for info and tickets. Please do check that out for the 23rd of October. I think that's all the focus intimations. Is that right, James? One more. Oh, there we go. Thank you. And reminder, mark your diaries for next month for the 27th of October. We'll have a shared lunch at the Church Center at 12:30. This will, as I mentioned before, that's the next meeting of our Super Sunday as well on the 27th of October. So it'll be a shared lunch edition. So please do prepare to come along. Yes, Leslie. Yes, I have more to go. Okay. So 27th of October, a shared lunch. Please do mark your diaries for that, and names and information will be taken in due course. But I have to announce as well that the new edition of Crossreach News is available, and in this new edition, there's a catalog for, dare I say the word, Christmas cards, and calendars are now available. It's coming up again. Also, we are in need of help in another area as well. We are in need of one or two people to volunteer some time to help as church officers. Suzanne and Charlie, for personal reasons, both need to temporarily step away from their duties as church officers, and we would be grateful for anyone who can give a little time to help with this responsibility. If you're able and willing to help, even on a temporary basis, as a church officer, please make your interest known to me or speak with Leslie McKay for more information. And last but not least, a reminder as well that as we've been doing the last few weeks, we'll continue with an opportunity for after-service prayer over in the side area of the church, and Judith Bale has happily agreed to be present for that time. So if you need a word of conversation or prayer on a confidential basis with someone, please see Judith. Can you raise your hand, Judith? After worship, she'll be off to the side over there. And I commend the rest of the intimations to us as in the print as well for your information. Yes, Anne.
Just a reminder, communion is next Sunday.
Thank you. We'll have communion next Sunday instead of on the first Sunday in October. So next Sunday, the 29th of September, we'll have communion in worship. Thank you, Anne. Any other intimations to share with our church family? Thank you very much. Let us now turn our hearts and minds to prayers for the world. Let us pray. Lord, your voice is ringing throughout the universe, throughout all space and time, Your voice seeks to reach our ears, to touch our hearts and our souls. Gracious God, help us to listen for your voice, calming and clear, throughout the chaos of our frenzied lives. Help us to hear you, and may you calm the voices roaring in our heads, the sounds roaring all around us. Help us to hear you as we pray for our world. Holy God, we listen for your guidance as we pray for the healing of our world. We ask for resolution of political, economic, and social paralysis and the uncertainty affecting the United Kingdom and the European Union over Brexit. May you give leaders on every side new vision, new desire, new willingness to seek your will and the good of all. We pray for the people of the Bahamas who have a long road of recovery ahead after Hurricane Dorian turned their world upside down. We also lift our hearts in prayer for Bermuda, where another hurricane knocked out the power for about 80% of the island. Help us, Lord, to give of what we can to help those rebuild their lives. This day we pray that we are given ears to hear the cries of your children throughout this globe as we wrestle with the continued impact of climate change. And we give you thanks for the global demonstrations of the climate strike last Friday. May these demonstrations create new solidarity amongst us as human beings. And may these demonstrations inspire those in power and positions of influence to push for real and radical change for the healing of our world. Loving God, we listen for your tranquility, especially when the clamor of gun violence, knife violence, rings so loudly in our heads. We pray for a cessation of violence, of hatred. We pray for change in the United States, where gun violence is all too prevalent, even 7 years after the school shooting at Sandy Hook Elementary. Give our leaders courage to act. We pray for the Middle East, especially in light of the Saudi Arabia oil attacks, that healing rather than hatred would win the day. We cry with those grieving in Afghanistan following the attacks by the Taliban yet again on innocent civilians. We pray that international pressure and resources would come to bear on those who seek to do violence against others. We pray for your protection and provisions for all seeking to help the wounded and the vulnerable. Lord, we believe you are speaking to us even now. We believe you are speaking a word of love and hope. Give us courage to be your hands, in your feet, your voice in our community. Help each of us in our own lives to live into your grace, to transform this world, to win it back to you. We pray these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. This story today, we heard these words of Samuel, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." We listen to God, we serve God, we submit our lives to God. And so in that spirit of faith, we now sing our closing song of praise, All to Jesus I surrender. Son, and Holy Spirit, may it rest upon each of us and upon all who we love, this day and forevermore.